Blessed morning, dear children. Welcome back to our social class. So, children, this time we have already completed this lesson in class. So, it's going to be a revision for you. Okay. So, what is the name of the lesson? Yes, it is Age of the Mauryas. Yes. So, here we call it as an empire, the Mauryan Empire. Why? Because the kingdom was much larger. Okay. That's why we call the Age of Mauryas as a Mauryan Empire. So, the Mauryas for the first time unified a large part of the subcontinent under one rule. So, from where do we get to know about the Mauryas? From the sources, isn't it? So, first, let's know about the sources. So, Indica by Megasthenes and Arthashastra by Kautilya are the two main literary sources. So, what does Indica tell children? It tells us about the political, social and economic condition of the Mauryan period. And Arthashastra describes the administration of the Mauryas. So, it also contains the instructions for the rulers on how to govern an empire. Okay, and the rock and the pillar edicts of Emperor Ashoka are an equally valuable source. And the Mauryan coins also inform us about the age of the Mauryas. So next we are going to learn about Chandragupta Maurya. Yes, 321 to 297 BC. So he is the first ruler of the Mauryan dynasty and he overthrew Danenanda. We learned in the last lesson, isn't it? The last Nanda ruler in 321 BC. So to put an end to this, he was advised by Chanakya. And Chandragupta first conquered which place? Magadha. Okay, and after consolidating his position in Magadha, he defeated the Greek governor, ended the Greek rule in Punjab. And then he conquered other parts of northern India. And Chandragupta Maurya also brought all those kingdoms and tribes and weakened by Alexander's invasion under his control. So next is about the invasion of Seleucus. So Seleucus Nicator, general of Alexander, ruled the area across river Indus. And he wanted to recover the areas which Alexander had conquered in India. And he was defeated by Chandragupta and made to sign a peace treaty. So last lesson we learnt about Alexander and Porus. Do you remember, children? Yeah. And Seleucus had to give Chandragupta eastern Afghanistan and Balochistan and areas beyond river Indus. And he also gave his daughter in marriage to Chandragupta. And in return, he obtained how many elephants? Yes, 500 elephants. And an ambassador of Seleucus called Megasthenes stayed in the court of Chandragupta Maurya for many years. So the next topic is role of Chanakya. So Chanakya is also known as by what name, children? Yes, Vishnugupta or Kautilya. Okay, and he was a learned Brahmin and he taught in the University of Takshila in the Northwest India. So we have already learned about Chanakya's guidance and wisdom. Yes, which helped Chandragupta to end the rule of the Nandas and conquer which place? Magadha. Okay, so when Chandragupta became the ruler, Chanakya became his chief advisor. So he guided Chandragupta in running the administration efficiently. And he is well known as the author of Arthashastra, a textbook on the duties and obligations of a ruler. So Bindusara 297 to 273 BCE, yes. So Bindusara is Chandragupta's son. Okay, so he was a successor. So under him, the Mauryan Empire stretched across the whole of the Indian subcontinent except for Kalinga. So Kalinga is present day Odisha and a few kingdoms in the south. So the Mauryas had friendly relations with the kingdoms of the south. So next we are going to revise about Emperor Ashoka. So, when did King Ashoka ascend his throne? Yes, in 273 BCE. So, he was one of the greatest Indian rulers and he extended the boundaries of the empire and governed it well. So, the rock and the pillar edicts spread over a large part of India and it provides us with a wealth of information about Ashoka's period. Kalinga War. So, Kalinga was the only kingdom which was not under the Mauryan control. So, it was strategically important as it controlled the land and the sea routes to South India and Southeast Asia. So, in 261 BCE, what happened? Ashoka attacked Kalinga and conquered it after a fierce battle. So, this battle was a turning point in the life of Ashoka. Why, children? Very good. Because of the death, destruction, and the suffering that he saw in the war touched him deeply. So he vowed, that is, he promised not to fight any more wars. And after the Kalinga War, Ashoka embraced which religion? Buddhism. And he devoted himself to the well-being of his people. Ashoka is Dhamma. So Dhamma is a Prakrit word for the Sanskrit term Dharma, which means religious duty. So Ashoka gave up the policy of conquest through war, that is Tik Vijaya, and began to follow a policy of conquest through Dharma, Dhamma Vijaya. So spreading Dhamma became Ashoka's goal in life. And the ethics of Ashoka tell us about his ideas of Dhamma. So it was a code of conduct and moral values inspired by the teachings of Buddha. So through his Dhamma, Ashoka wanted to instill a spirit of tolerance, coexistence, non-violence, and respect for elders and the people. So he asked his people to follow these things. What are those? Speak truth, respect other religions, follow the path of Ahimsa, be charitable to the poor, be kind to all, including servants and slaves, and respect and obey elders and live together peacefully. So these were his principles of Dhamma. So what was King Ashoka's welfare measures and how did he spread Dharma? So Ashoka was deeply concerned about the welfare of his people, and in one of his edicts he says, "All men are my children, and just as I desire for my children that they should obtain welfare and happiness both in this world and the next, the same do I desire for all men." That means he treated all men and women equally, and he wanted for the happiness of the people. Okay, and he had done a good measures. So what are they? Yes, he built good roads, planted trees on both sides of the road. He constructed rest houses for travelers, built many hospitals, both for people and animals. And he regularly went on tours and tried to solve the problems of his subjects. And Ashoka wanted people to understand Dhamma and follow it in their day-to-day activities. So for that, he has taken some steps. So first, he was led by example. So he was himself an example, and he followed the principles of Dhamma in his daily life. Next, he appointed officials called Dharma Mahamatras. Very good. To spread Dharma. So these officers went from place to place and spread the message of Dhamma. Then he issued many edicts which contained the principles of Dhamma. And the edicts described the reforms carried out by Ashoka, and the language used for the edicts was Prakrit, which was a local language. And these edicts were engraved on rocks and pillars, and they were put in different parts of his empire and all public places. Okay, so where many people would gather and they would find all those things. Okay, children, so this is what we learned in class. Do you remember? So the administration of Ashoka. So the Mauryan administration can be studied under the four heads: central, provincial, district, and village. So the capital city of Pataliputra was administered separately. Okay. So the administration of Ashoka after his spiritual transformation was focused solely on the well-being of his subjects, as we learned already. So first, central. The king was the supreme authority, and he took all the important decisions concerning the empire. And he was assisted by a council of ministers called the Mantri Parishad. And the various branches of the administration were under the officials called Amatyas. Next is provincial. So the empire was divided into provinces, each headed by a prince. And he ruled the province as a representative of the king and was assisted by many officials. Then becomes the districts. So provinces were further divided into districts, and the pradeshta was the head of the district, and he was assisted by the junior officials called the yuktas and the rajukas. So they measured the land, collected taxes, and maintained law and order. Next is about the villages. So a number of villages made up the district, and the village is assisted government officials in marking the village boundaries, maintaining land records, and collecting taxes. And okay, and each village had a headman who was chosen by the villages themselves. And next is about the city of Pataliputra. It is very important. Pataliputra is the present day Patna. Okay, and it was surrounded by a wooden wall which has 64 gates and 570 towers. And I also told you example for this. Yes, Bahubali movie. Do you remember? And a committee of 30 members looked after the city. And this committee was divided into six boards comprising five members each. Like, each board looked after the specific department. So next is about the army of the Mauryas. So the Mauryas had a large standing army which included infantry, that means soldiers with weapons, and cavalry, that is soldiers who fight on the horseback, elephants, chariots, and the navy. And a separate department looked after the production of weapons. And the Senapati was the head of the army, and though the king himself led the troops in wars. And the army was equipped with weapons such as bows, arrows, swords, armors, and shields. Okay. So next is about the spy system of the Mauryan Empire. So the Mauryan rulers maintained an efficient spy system, and spies, many of whom were women, were posted in different parts of the country, and they informed the king about the developments both within and outside the kingdom. Economy during the Mauryan Empire. So the Indian economy by this time is a settled agrarian economy, and animal rearing continued to be an important occupation, and industry and business also flourished here. And with agriculture being the backbone of the Indian economy, it was quickly realized that the land revenue was going to be a major source of income for the government. So we learned under taxation, isn't it? Yes. And there is also a reference to water tax in Arthashastra we learned in our textbook. Do you remember? And industries and enterprises were also taxed using a vast mix of techniques, and all of which were derived from the original land revenue tax system. And this entire system was the brainchild of Kautilya. Okay, the two sources, Arthashastra and Kautilya. So both Megasthenes and Kautilya tell us about the Mauryan society. And according to Megasthenes, the upper class, that is the Brahmins, Kshatriyas and the Vaishyas, continue to enjoy their privileged position. Next is about the Mauryan art. So the Mauryan art reached its perfection during Ashoka's period, and the remains of stupas, stone pillars and monasteries reflect the Mauryan craftsman's mastery over stone. And it is believed that Ashoka built over 84,000 stupas and viharas. And the most famous stupa, which is the most famous stupa? The Great Stupa. And the stupas were surrounded by railings and had many gateways. And then we learnt about viharas, isn't it? Yeah. So viharas or monasteries were places where the Buddhist monk lived. And they were carved out of the solid rock and had a metal-like polish. And they have beautifully carved tops called the capitals, which bear animal figures. And the most famous pillars were at Sarnath near Varanasi. And we have that four lines sitting back to back facing the four directions are carved on its top, isn't it? And below each line is a chakra or wheel. And this line capital is now the national emblem of India. So I told you I will be showing you the line capital. Yes, today I will be showing you, okay, in the class. And the pillar at Lauriya Nandangarh is another masterpiece, and it also has an animal capital on the top. So how did the Mauryan Empire collapse or come to an end? So Ashoka died in the year 232 BC, and the dynasty continued for another 50 years. But the empire ceased to be strong and powerful, and there were many reasons for the decline. So Ashoka was succeeded by a series of weak rulers who were unable to control and manage the vast empire. And the empire had grown too big, and provinces far away from the center became difficult to control, and they gradually became independent. And the empire grew financially weak, as it spent a vast amount of money in maintaining the large army and running its elaborate administration. And the last Mauryan ruler was Brihadratha, and he ruled over a small area. And in 185 BCE, his commander-in-chief Pushyamitra Sunga killed him, and thus ending the rule of the Mauryas. And finally, the Mauryan rule came to an end. Okay. So, my dear children, please learn your daily lessons and complete your classwork. Okay, up till date. Thank you, children. Have a great day.